Hello learners, welcome to the October month current affairs. This is the first session we'll be taking in the October month. So in this session, we'll be taking the four things, that is indexes, reports, surveys, both Indian and international, then committees, because you have a lot of stuff to be covered in a very less time, a current affair, so as to maintain the efficiency. So I'll go a bit fast. Okay, these are the online videos. You can slow it down or pause in between to get the feeling. I'll try to be thorough, but some things you have to keep in check so that efficiency is increased, and in the less time we can cover more facts. And also, just to whatever we have discussed in the introduction video, just to reiterate that I won't be discussing too much into the static contemporary static complementary part, because that is not the purpose of this class, right? So I'll be cross-referencing with the other videos, the other courses on the online on the YouTube, other videos, and also some of the static things. So I hope you complement with this class the other things. But this class is specifically for the prelims current affair, not even mains. But wherever some mains things can be added, I'll definitely point out to that, so that if someone wants to add value to your mains answer writing also, they can value with these prelims facts. Okay, let's begin. So as I said, we'll be discussing the indexes, committees, places in news, both Indian and international. And lastly, some factual things, some random factual things that are outside the domain of ecology, economy, as in we categorize like that, so as to give you a structure. And we'll follow the same structure in all the months, all the relevant ones, from the June 2019 to the March or April 2020. So that's to prepare you for the prelims 2020. Okay. So first of all, indexes and reports. So first is international indexes. First, Global Competitiveness Index, released by World Economic Forum. Now, in the static need, you need to know what is World Economic Forum, where is the headquarter, that is Geneva. It is said to be one of the currently it's said to be one of the largest platform where all the decision makers, especially the neoliberal post globalization regime, this forum has become very prominent, releasing important documents, important video, working as a think tank and some things. Recently, Mr. Modi, Indian Prime Minister, went for the first time on this platform and talked about it. World Economic Forum also hosts various events. Recent one has the theme of globalization. Apart from this, they have the theme of globalization 4.0. So for optionals and your GS1, you can add this theme and you can write the example that for Economic Forum is the theme of globalization 4.0. Coming back to the topic, so Global Competitiveness Index annually done by World Economic Forum. What is counterintuitive in that India moved 10 places below. Now, I said counterintuitive because everywhere improving. We'll see that also today, that ease of doing business, we are improving, but competitiveness index, we are reduced 10 down places. And first time it feature Global Competitiveness Index also. Okay, so how India has fared. So if you see over the years, early 63, then we improved to 58, and again we 10 points down to 68. Ranking across the parameter is not important, as important as the ease of doing business. But still, from the mains, as I told you, you can remember, for example, IC adaptation, we still have a lot, a long way to go. We are very good in the market size, you can see third number, because of the sheer population and the area of the country. Dynamism has also declined, and skill sets, there the problem lies, the social infrastructure, right? So you can, whenever you're writing, you can add value by quoting these. These are prominent reports. Government also quote these reports so as to give credibility to their programs, okay? So how they stack up. So first one is taken by the Singapore. And you just remember that which country has topped and where the India is placed. And if they go to the next level, they will ask among the BRICS countries. So BRICS may, Brazil has 71st rank. India is not the worst performing in BRICS and not the best performing in BRICS. Just remember that. So Brazil is after India. Okay. So if they ask a tough question on this, for example, Quality Council of India, they asked in 2016-17. So these are tough current affairs. Otherwise, current affairs are relatively easy. If you have just surfacial knowledge, so you will be able to get it done. Okay. So next is, as these parameters as we discussed. So India places six places on the Global Competitiveness Index, and Singapore on the top. One of the worst performing in the BRICS. So just remember, not the worst performing, but one of the among the worst performing. Brazil is after it. we get to global hunger index. Global hunger index released by, not by FAO first of all, because if the options are set, FAO must be there. Food and Agriculture Organization set up based in Rome. No, that is not there. It is jointly by Irish Aid Agency Concern Worldwide and German organization Welt Hunger Life. Some of the articles also came that why this report, which portrays India into such a bad light, is not credible. Also, Hindu, some of the reports come, but that is not from the prelims perspective. So, India's rank, we can see that they are 102 out of 117. In 2018, we were 103. So, we are marge fractionally improved. But if you see in 2017, we were 100 rank was there. So, the calculation is based upon four. These indicators are important because this has become a prominent index, because SDG goal 2 is also there, zero hunger. And they also talk about hidden hunger, right? The malnutrition problem facing the world and their relation to climate change and all. So now hunger after poverty is being a powerful topic. Now after poverty, hunger, especially the malnutrition, we'll discuss within the October month. So many reports on these nutrition, hunger from both India and international came. So that will also tell you the trend of policy making from poverty eradication to discussing the manifestation of poverty. Now they're moving from that to the next level. So, what is undernourishment? Everybody knows child wasting and shunting and mortality. Mortality is under 5 year. Mortality rate under 5 year. Now, one of the two confusing concept is wasting and shunting, right? So in wasting and shunting, if we see in the diagram, this is shunting. The boy is not able to grow height with respect to age. So that is height. This is one of the tricky, small, is very simple conceptual things are there, but when UPSC asks them, it becomes sometimes difficult to remember it on the spot. And wasting is, you see, he is very thin. So he is thin, his weight, it is not with respect to age, weight with respect to height. Because it is expected that when the height increases, weight will increase, bone density and all these things. So these things are not conceptually important, but these two are important. So, if we see again, this thing, child wasting, what is this? Under the age of 5, who are low weight for their height, and child shunting is low height for their age. Just remember that. Shunting and wasting. Very simple question. Very simple question on this concept can be asked. We prepare for so many indexes and all, but if the small question comes and if you get it rank, then that will be not good. So, what about India? India, as I discussed, 102 rank, some Central African Republic, very poor. And Pakistan even better than us. Bangladesh is doing good on social infrastructure. Nothing more to be bothered for this index, right? Over the years, if we see, for example, 103 was in 2018, 100, 103, 102, right? We are in that arena. Next report is from IMF. It is published biannually. Within 2 years, it is published every 2 years. World Economic Forum, that is World Economic Outlook, not Forum. Why? IMF, right? So just remember that. So the heading is Global Manufacturing Downturn, Rising Trade Barriers. So they have given global projections, they will do, but no need to put too much attention to global projection. You can remember it for mains, but not for pre-perspective. Only the report name is important. Next, we come to a very important report, ease of doing, because government is paying a lot of attention to ease of doing business. A lot of steps have been taken to improve the bottlenecks associated with the ease of doing business index. So we have moved to, we are constantly moving. We'll see that from 77, we moved to 63rd. We'll also see where are the areas where we are lacking. So 10 different dimensions are there of ease of doing business. First of all, India's jump. We were somewhere, you see here, from here. In 2014, the regime change took place, and from there to 63. This index itself cannot be said to be the absolute measure of India's manufacturing prowess or increasing manufacturing potential, but it is one of the indicators, and that is what is criticized also. On the one hand, we are witnessing the IIP going negative and the manufacturing sentiments not getting up, but on the other hand, we are increasing in this index. So that is why comprehensive outlook is required. We cannot only rely on ease of doing business index for our checking our manufacturing prowess, as in manufacturing output. So big areas of improvement since 2018, solvency, we have improved because of insolvency and bankruptcy code, IBC, insolvency and bankruptcy code, dealing with construction permit, trading cross border, starting a business, startup India and all right, the reforms taken. But yeah, so goods can be seen here. So rank as we discussed, 140, 140, 200, 77, now 63. Now government wants to get into 50, below 50. And we are doing well also as far as this index is concerned. So what are the goods we discussed? The bads one, for example, enforcement of the contract, that still remains an issue. This year economic survey told that the state of matsinyaya, anarchy established, anarchy is there at the subordinate level when there are so much burden of the cases. Last year economic survey came up with a study on the taxation, how many cases are pending in the taxation and how it is affecting our GDP. So enforcement of contract will be done by the criminal justice system. How efficient our laws are, how efficient our protection of those laws and by these judiciary is there, right? Getting credit, protecting minority investment, we are very good rank at it. Also getting credit is good, but doesn't matter. But the enforcement of contract is a big issue. Okay. So they are also trying to expand. They are trying to eradicate the problems. Obviously, the World Bank is also improving. Ease of doing business is released by World Bank, right? Source World Bank, just to reinforce the thought. So they are also trying to improve. They are also, don't need to remember all this. They are coming up with the new contracting with the government. They are trying to come up with new indexes so that government can work on those indexes and can improve upon. The whole idea behind indexes, as in India, we see Nitya presenting so many indexes, we'll see also today. Competitive federalism within India and competition among the countries so as to improve on these indexes. So what get measures gets improved. That is the philosophy. If you can measure something, then you can improve upon that. Okay. Next is status of child's World Child Report, that is from UNICEF. So UNICEF is presenting this report. Title is Children, Food and Nutrition Growing Well in the Changing World. Children, Food and Nutrition Growing Well in the Changing World. So it talks about the triple burden of malnutrition, undernutrition, hidden hunger and overweight. So malnutrition does not mean less accessibility. That means also absorption. Some other components are also there. So it converts undernutrition, hidden hunger and overweight. Okay. So the same thing, growing well in the changing world, right? The images are there just to reinforce the thoughts, because cramming only the facts can be very tricky and very tough. So what you need, some images so that you can associate. If you memorize with respect to images, you will be able to get better output. Many of the times students are not able to revise their current affairs. So if you just watch this video, just revise it once and you're done. Even if you're not able to revise the third time, the probability is you'll get the questions right. The comprehensiveness of this video of the current affairs we are covering, we promise that if you watch from the June to the April part, you'll cover almost all the current affairs. That is the effort we are putting in this video. Okay, so next we come World Development Report, very important report by World Bank. They release very good reports from 2015 onwards, some very good reports. If you want to improve your understanding in the governance and want to have some intellectual insights into areas of poverty, development, then you have a look, cursory look in the development report. So this year report came on trading for development, like the importance of trading for development and in the age of global value chains. Global value chains means, as in something is created in India, for example, iPhone is conceptualized in US, created, manufactured in India and sold in all over the world, right? Now currently new units are coming up in India also. The global value chains, as in the value is added across the globe. The product cannot be said to be specifically coming from the one place, and that is the result of the globalization, especially in this time of technology, right? Next, the main thing, you can make this, this is a good diagram given by the world, that is from the report itself, that global value chains have the kind of hyper-specialization and the firm relationships. They rely on these. The driver of these global value chains are policies, openness, connectivity and cooperation. We can see geography, endowments, market size and institutions. These are the drivers for the chain. And what will the outcome? We can see outcomes in the form of jobs and growth, environment, poverty reduction and equality. Through trade, because development will come. Because after 1990, when the trade has increased a lot, then only we saw an absolute increase and the relative decrease, absolute decrease and also the relative decrease in the poverty across the world. China was able to put so many people out of poverty. Recent report also said that from 2006 to 2013, India pulled out more than 258 million people out of the poverty. Okay. So these facts are only for the mains and just something like that. Okay. Next, we come to the next report because the mains cannot ignore, right? Mains is the real deal. Asia Pacific Trade and Investment Report. So it is given by United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia and Pacific and UNCTAD, that is United Nations Conference on Trade and Development. So just remember, UNCTAD is very important because many of the good reports of given by this organization. We'll discuss that, and also later on around March we'll try to come up with a compilation of it also. But you should not ignore the facts monthly also. Okay. So, non-tariff measures have increased in the past 2 years. The details they give that how non-tariff measures have been increased and they stem the development thing. This free and fair trade, they they create issue for that. So, this is the report. This is UNCTAD and UNCTAD and ESAP, UNESCAP. So, these two organizations have come up with this report. Navigating non-tariff measures towards sustainable development. Because still this is a core belief that sustainable development goal, Paris Agreement pledges, the Sendai framework, we cover somewhere Sendai framework, disaster management, all this can be done only and only if through the money generated by the free and fair trade, right? So balance, barriers of the trade, this is a main thing, tariff and non-tariff, you just look at it, so there's a complementary static read, okay? We'll move on. 2017 global burden of the disease study. So this is done by Institute of Health Metrics and Evaluation, University of Washington. So University of Washington is coming up with this study. What they believe that malnutrition is said to be the leading cause of the death in India, following the dietary risk, including the poor diet choices. The same thing as I told you, that so many reports on the malnutrition, hunger, these things, right? Okay. So, just tell me, this is University of Washington, right? So, where is Washington? There are two Washingtons in US. Just keep that in mind just for your general awareness. One is DC and another is the Washington State. Washington State, that is, if you see, that is the map of US. That is Washington State and this is Washington DC. A same image I have put for you. Just for fun, that many times people ask that Washington, where is the Washington? Washington State is different. Washington DC is different. So, this is Washington State. Seattle is there. And this is Washington, you can see, around 3000 mile distance. Okay, next come index, online labor index. Online labor index, these small indexes, why you need to prepare? They may not have that much significance as compared to ease of doing business report. But if you remember all the relevant reports, so their confidence will increase, right? I'll keep on repeating this throughout our journey. We'll have a very long journey together because so many content, so much content to be covered. So I'll just cover one thing, the content and confidence, right? Many of my students know that I repeat this line, but this line is key to clearing prelims and also mains, that you have content, but you also need confidence. And confidence will come from reading all these very factual facts. Why? When you know all this, though, I've covered all the arenas, all the possible things I have done, then only you feel confidence and then you are able to tackle even the tough questions of UPSC, right? Okay, so it is released by Oxford Internet Institute. India leads the global gig economy with 24% share of the online labor market. So what is gig economy? We'll cover somewhere. Gig economy, obviously, surely we'll cover somewhere, but it's homework from your side. What you can do with that, you can, if you, someone is interested, they can add in the comments area, all the homeworks that I'm giving, okay? But let's be sure, if anything is current affair, we'll be covering somewhere over the line. I can give you just the example of the economy, Uber, Ola, freelancer teachers, freelancer worker, freelancer media editor, something like that, okay? Now we come to India, now we come to the international indexes, now we come to Indian indexes. First is Indian Innovation Index. Indian Innovation Index, for Indian Index, I give you a hack, what do you do? Indian indexes in India, what you do, just remember by default that they are given by Niti Aayog, and if some exception is there, just remember those exceptions, For example, good governance index is given by someone else. So just remember those Leeds index. We'll discuss all those indexes, Leeds index. They will come somewhere in around the current affair area. But these are the specific October current affair. So Leeds index is conducted by other institute. So there are only few indexes which are covered by other institutes. So make by default that these are covered by Niti Aayog, and just remember the exceptions. So Indian Innovation Index, Niti Aayog with the Institute of Competitiveness at the Knowledge Partner ranking. Karnataka is the most innovative major state. This is Karnataka, right? Just remember that. The recent state PCS of UP PCS, UP has asked the same question. Which state has topped the innovation index? Index is a great beginning to improve the environment of innovation in the country, as it focuses on both input and the output component of the idea. Okay. So you can see, as I told you, you relate the facts with the images of the people. So this is Amitabh Kant, the CEO of Niti Aayog, right? So he is launching Indian Innovation Index. Major states I discussed, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra. Bottom ones, obviously, so Bimaru states, right? Earlier, this terminology was used. Now, the attitude has changed, okay? Next is National Diabetes and the Diabetic Retinopathy Survey Report for 2015-19. So, released by Health Ministry. And in crux, it says that and the risk of NCD is increasing in India, and especially diabetes. India is said to become the diabetic capital of the world. India and China are the hotbeds of diabetes. Rise in NCDs, less physical workout, because awareness of too much physical workout is not there. Too much focus on studies, the whole idea of education system, that education should also imbibe within it. Sports becomes a very integral component of education system that is being missing in India. So you can see prevalence of the very young ones also, pre-diabetic and also diabetic. Okay. Next is National SEQI. So by default, it is released by Niti Aayog. And yes, it is by default that it is released by Niti Aayog. Best performing states are Kerala and Rajasthan. So these index are largely based on the data from NAS. We'll cover NAS somewhere. National Achievement Survey and UDISE, Unified District Information School Data of 2016-17. So remember that it is based upon the data from these surveys. These can be good fodder for the mains. Okay. To encourage a data-driven policy reforms. Next. So the category, if we summary of the indexes of category, so outcome, you can see domain, learning outcome, access outcome, infrastructure, facilities or outcome, equity outcomes. So these, on these indicators, the different weight is given, and then the index is calculated. Currently, it's been like Niti Aayog is trying new indexes. So they won't go into too much into domains, but just keep your mind open. Okay, just read it once. Don't put too much effort into it. Just remember the SEQE by Niti Aayog and which state came first. You can just remember that within two category, one outcome. Obviously, one will be outcome and one will be governance. If you have read Niti Aayog 3-year action agenda, they have given one of the recommendations that we should come up with a very good comprehensive index to measure this. So that is a step in that direction only. 3-year action agenda. Okay. Next, the same thing, Kerala, Rajasthan and Karnataka. Okay. Next, National Air Quality Index. So very old topic, but always in news. Done by CPCB under launched 2014 in the Swachh Bharat Mission. 6 AQA categories. It is color coded. You can see good, satisfactory, moderate, poor, very poor, severe. And in Delhi, almost always somewhere you'll find the air quality like there. 8 pollutants are covered. Just remember the 8 pollutants, and always remember that compare with NOx. When we'll discuss that, we'll again come to AQI to compare for comparative study. So remember the 8 pollutant, 2 PMs are there, PM10 plus PM2.5. You can take NO2, SO2 together. You can make ammonia and lead together. So remember it by making a group, small groups. PM10, PM2.5, NO2, SO2. CO2, O3, something like CO, not CO2. Actually, one of the question was also, carbon dioxide is not the part, only CO, carbon monoxide is the part. Remember, CO, not CO2. One of the most interesting thing you can find, that question can be asked if they ask a tough question. So only 10 cities now have it, not all the country, and they're thinking to make it accessible to more cities, right? So each of the cities will have these stations. And yes, also remember one fact that, just one second, yeah. Also remember one fact that when the AQI increases, number increases, for example, this is 1, this is 500. So with 500, the quality decreases. Many a times we know everything about the fact, but sometimes we miss all these small, small details. For example, you can see here, 1 to 50 is good, but 1 to 400 is severe. So as the number increases, number on the index increases, it is a problem for you. So these are the eight indicators by CPCB. Okay. Next, livestock census report. Now this report is good, important, because after 2012-2019 report has came. Few small facts that we'll have to see. First of all, release by the release is not tough because livestock is there. So Department of Animal Husbandry and Dairying will be there, right? So it is conducted periodically since 1920. So it has a huge legacy with it. So it covers all the domesticated animals and head counts both in rural and urban area. Head count in both rural and urban area. Various species of animal are counted. Various species. We'll also see important ones. And capture breed wise number of animals and the poultry birds. Okay. NIC, National Informatics Center, helps help them to develop that for data collection. Rankings are not too much important in my opinion, but still UP has the highest number of people and they also have the highest number of livestock population. Highest increase is seen in Bihar. So I don't think you have to remember last time conducted in 2012 as we discussed. Okay. So conducted by Ministry of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare livestock census. Okay. Next is livestock headcount. Now what question can you expect that increase or if they want to ask a tough question on economy, you can say that's an economy, but from the current affair, for example, the question is cattle are more or buffaloes are more or sheep are more or goats are more. Just remember it is cattle, then you can go for goats, then buffaloes. If you do not know this, then you cannot make an answer in a very short term. So just if you know now, you know a fact, that's it. If the question come and you are able to do it. So cat, then goat, then buffalo, then sheep. Next, if there are any factual mistakes you find in the PPT, if I say something and something is different, feel free to make it in the comment area so that we can also improve upon it, right? Comprehensive National Nutrition Survey. Comprehensive National Nutrition Survey 2000. Again, that same thing, nutrition, malnutrition. Keep that in mind. Huh? So that is why you can expect too many essays and Jimmy's question on it from GS 1, 2, 3, 4. You can expect at least one essay at core or peripheral areas. So Indian child double burden and all the same things. So survey is to access the use gold standard method to access anemia, micronutrient deficiency. It is the largest micronutrient survey. This you need to remember. It is the largest one. Right. Next, nutrition vows. So you can see one of the interesting facts that these, for example, as the ad goes darker, the nutrition problem, you can see in the rich states also this problem is there. Especially the problem of NCD is also there, right? You see, what I was discussing that this 10% children, adolescent, pre-diabetic, 4% have high cholesterol, something. So these facts are very disturbing. Committees in use. Now we have finished all the indexes, reports, surveys we have focused of October month. We will try to give a compilation at the end of the March or something, right? We'll do that. We'll definitely try to do that. If not in soft copy, then if not in video format, then in the soft copy format. But we will surely do that. So committees in use. First is Satyanarayan committee. It is submitted. He has submitted the National Digital Health Blueprint. What is this health blueprint? It is it will help to National Health Stack. National Health Stack is, just remember, we'll cover National Health Stack in the government scheme part. So National Health Stack is basically digital, the putting all the health data on the digital form. Why? The whole point with which Niti Aayog is working, one of the important pillar of Niti Aayog, that is data driven governance. Many of time, as you said, na, data is the new oil. This rhetoric is too much in the news. But you see, the data is missing in India, whether education, whether it's health, a lot of data is missing. So National Health Stack want to put a digital India footprints into the health sector And with respect to that, Mr. Satyanarayan has put up his recommendations named National Digital Health Blueprint. Okay, it's an architectural document for implementation of National Health Stack. So it's just a beginning. And what is the goal? Biggest leap for to achieve the universal health coverage. This is a clipping from the PIB, important clipping. Okay, so Mr. Satyanarayan, the formal chairman UDI and chairman of National Digital Health Blueprint, okay, committee. Next, Amitabh Kant panel. It was set up. Mr. Amitabh Kant has to discuss CEO Nitya to expedite the privatization of trains. IRCTC. First train which became a privatized IRCTC. It also gain a lot of profit also. So Ministry of Railways has constituted an empowered group of secretaries to work on the development of 50 railway stations and operations of the 150 trains to the private operators. Okay. Next is Rajiv Gauba committee. In 2018, it is set up to make recommendation for checking the incident of mob lynching. Pehlu Khan, Tabriz Ansari. So mob lynching was a big concern. Supreme Court also said that come up with a law. It is against the horrendous act against the humanity. It violates the dignity of an individual, this mob lynching. So Supreme Court said that come up with the law. So currently Mr. Rajiv Gauba, cabinet secretary, this committee has been formed under him 2019. So point of concerns, you can read it, some penalties, some course of action, whatever he has recommended, that what should be done for the mob lynching. That's more in the main syllabus. That's a complementary main study you need to do. I have just put the picture. If you can use the extract the material of it, that is good for you. Next, Rajiv Gauba committee, because too much facts to be covered, right? So Rajiv Gauba committee in 2019, it is for the health, the Stuxnet telecom sector, especially after Geo revolution. We'll also read about one of the current thing IUC that they have put. So this telecom sector is under a lot of distress. Many of the majority companies are reeling under the pressure of too much financial. For example, spectrum cost is rising, but competition, predatory pricing is there. So that is why they have to adjust the cost thing. That's an issue. Okay. So next is that's just a high level advisory group. Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Department of Commerce has set up a high level advisory group. Now this is, I don't expect it to come, but they have set up it. That is why we need to learn it. So what their function is, examine the global economic scenario and performance of the India's trade and give the recommendation in the lights of India's historic economic and trade policy challenges. Okay. So just remember that examine the global economic scenario and performance of India's trade and given recommendation in the light of historic economic and trade policy. So again, the PIB clippings are because to give more authenticity to the fact, so that if you do not think that that come from outside or something not important. No, these are important. These are taken from the credible sources, right? So you can read the same things are given. Huh? Contemporary global scenario, that is high level advisory group. Next is Malimat committee. It's not set up now. It is set up in 2013. Why it is in news? Because the government is pondering, because criminal justice system is reeling under a lot of pressure, right? From the police to judiciary to prison. Problems are too much. More than 66% of the people in the prison are under trial. So that shows the very poor nature of Indian criminal justice system. So Malimat committee is there for reforms in the criminal justice system, crime investigation and punishment. Okay. Next is reforming criminal justice system. So government is to bring a standalone legislation on the Bail Act. So these, for example, this one is a good recommendation and this being implemented by the government also, CCTNS. For example, in my internal security class, I also teach that integration of CCTNS with the e-court and e-prison to help the reduce number of under trials. So that there is one integrated data, where it is sharing with the police, sharing of the data across the police, because police is a state subject. So many times they work in silos. The police of one state does not share data with the other. So that creates a lot of burden, as in if the sharing of the data is not there, then any crime conducted on the across the state. So these things just left out. So that is why Malimat committee gave some very interesting recommendations. For example, this one, restorative justice. A concept where victim gets a role even before the investigation initiated may negotiate and settle the dispute. Plea bargaining type thing. Not exactly, but plea bargaining type. Okay. Now we come to the third part of our discussion, that is location in India. We're going at a good pace, covering a lot of facts in the less time. So we'll cover the locations in India. First is Mechuka and Vijayanagar advanced landing grounds. I'll try to cover more and more important locations, but a lot of detail is not there obviously, because if the location itself is important and why it is in news, these two, majorly these two points are important. So location is in Arunachal Pradesh. Why it is in news? Because LAF opens advanced landing ground in the Arunachal Pradesh. It is close to China, so some strategic things are important for AF. Okay. Next, Array Forest, too much in news, right? Everybody knows it's in Mumbai, Maharashtra, so it can come. So the metro project, as you can see, the metro and the classical debate of development versus environment. We can cover that somewhere in essay, but not here. Okay. Okay. Next is Rangdum Monastery. So location is in Ladakh. Monastery is in UPSC two times, art and culture. That's a static read for you, or we'll cover in our impetus series. If you have seen, it is on the YouTube. We'll also give reference, many of the content I've just put here. You can see detailed content in the impetus series. It is already, videos are already on the YouTube. Tiger Reserve videos are on YouTube and other videos are in the process. So the Archaeological Survey is planning to declare a monument of national importance, this monastery, right? Just remember Ladakh. And how can you remember this monastery? Only by remembering the other monasteries. So I've covered this monastery because this is in news. You have to cover other monasteries from the art and culture, your static contemporary, static read. I'm just reminding you that these are the current affairs. Then Kabini River flows through Kerala and Karnataka, tributary of Kaveri. So Kaveri, if you can see the state boundaries, this is Tamil Nadu, right? This is Kerala. So your Kaveri is river is this, right? This one, and Kabini can be seen here. Yeah, Kabini. Okay. Mettur Dam, you can see here. Mettur Dam, Krishna Raj Sagar Dam. Okay. Very good tourist destination also, Krishna Raj Sagar. I've been to the behind the dam. It's very good. Next, NH-776. NHs are actually, they have changed names so times because they're not that makes them not too much important for the examination. But this one is important. Why? It says NH project NH-77 save the Wayanad. The same issue of development versus environment. These can examples can be done from Kozhikode in Kerala to Kolegal in Karnataka. Passes through Bandipur National Park and Wayanad Wildlife Sanctuary. Again, the impetus series that I have discussed, it has very detailed. I have discussed about Bandipur Nagar Hole, then Bandipur Nagar Hole is also known as the Rajiv Gandhi National Park. It is not mentioned here, but it is mentioned in the impetus series. So through Bandipur National Park, Wayanad Wildlife Sanctuary, every with very detailed map, it is mentioned there. Okay. Next, this is Nagar Hole, this is Bandipur. Same images I have also used there. So 776, that's causing a problem. Track Island, Andaman in Nicobar. Why it is important, why it is in news, or why we should take care of it? Because testing of the missiles like BrahMos sometimes done here. BrahMos surface missile test back by FAA at Track Island. So remember, the Track Island is not somewhere in Pacific or something, it is in the Andaman and Nicobar. McMahon line, again static read, but McMahon line is the de facto border between Arunachal Pradesh and China today. China does not agree to it, obviously. Decided 2014 Shimla Convention. So China argued that we were actually in the modern PRC became, they become modern PRC, modern state China became in 1949, right? 1st January 1949, I guess. So in Shimla Convention, the earlier part, they had some dealing with the British India. So current China does not agree to it. That is why they consider one of the six provinces, so six districts of Arunachal Pradesh as their own territory, right? So this is my Mohan line, this is Arunachal Pradesh. So this is like this area, disputed area, something like that. Okay. Shri Venkateshwara Zoological Park, location Andhra Pradesh. Nothing extra to be done here, but it was in the news, that is why we discussed. Kaval Wildlife Sanctuary, again impetus series, we very clearly mentioned it. The location, it is in Telangana, Nadan Telangana. We can see Telangana, we have two. One is Kaval, another one is, you just find in the impetus series. right? Armabad is there. So you just find find that in the impetus series. Some details are also there. Again, Pobitora Wildlife Sanctuary in the Assam district. Assam. So it is nearby the high concentration of Varna rhino, nearby the monk, that is Manas, Orang, Nameri and Kaziranga. Again, something discussed in the impetus series. It's very important. For prelims, I'll suggest you that I've taken the impetus series. Some very good facts for prelims will be covered. These questions will become very easy. You don't have to cover these in current affair if you just follow that series. Next is Nagarjun Sagar Sarisilam. Again, it is in the largest tiger reserve, first of all. The Armabad and Nagarjun Sarisilam are very contiguous. For example, this is Telangana, this is Andhra Pradesh, so this is Armabad and this is Nagarjun Sarisilam. Actually, that's only one tiger reserve. But because of the state boundary, now they have divided into two. Kanha National Park, Kanha is in MP. MP, we have national parks like Panna, Bandhavgarh, Kanha. Whenever the news will come, we will discuss that. But everything is covered in. Again, I'm really sorry, but these things are covered. That's why I'm going very quickly. I hope you see those videos also, so as to give you more perspective to the prelims, right? Next is Kol Chewang Rinchen Setu. Colonel Chewang Rinchen Setu. So this Setu is made up in eastern Ladakh, inaugurated. India's highest all-weather permanent bridge is there. So this bridge is on the Shok River. Shok River, which is the tributary of, tell me the comment, which is the tributary of which? So strategically located between the Leh and the Karakoram Pass. So basically it is nearby China. So that is why it becomes very important. Last year, so many bridges were inaugurated in the Assam also. Bogabil Bridge. So you just also keep a track on the bridges, big bridges, because anytime UPSC can ask with the location, one bridge was there. We'll discuss that. Definitely it will come somewhere down the line. We'll discuss that. Also, we can give the compilation of bridges also. So that will be helpful. So this is why he is famous. He is the only one of the six Air Force personnel to have been twice awarded the Mahavir Chakra, the second highest, which is the highest, Paramvir Chakra. So Mahavir Chakra, he has been given the twice. Next, we have finished Indian location. We'll cover the now international. This is should be AL, yeah, international locations. So first location is Bhashan Char facility, Thengar Char. So these facilities, refugee camp for Bangladesh in Rohingya, these are the refugee camps for Bangladesh, for Rohingyas. So these islands were formed from the Himalayan silt in 2016 in the mouth of the river Meghna. So you see the alluvial, for example, from this image you can understand this Ganga, when it enters, this becomes Padma and Brahmaputra. So there they form a lot of delta, right? So this is formed, this Bhashan Char, and this is formed by the depositional landform, contemporary static read. Depositional landform it is there, so on which the Rohingyas are now placed. There is also Cox Bazar. Just look at the location of Cox Bazar also in your maps. We'll discuss sometime Cox Bazar in news. So it is nearby there, somewhere over here. Cox Bazar is there. So these are set up facilities for the Rohingyas. Okay, very easy. Yeah, Cox Bazar. Oh, sorry, I'm really sorry. Cox Bazar is there. Yes, you can see Cox Bazar. Not there. I'm sorry. There, Cox Bazar is there. So it can also, really very tough question, internationally they want to or in North South, I don't think so. But Bhashan Char and Cox Bazar, because this news is too much into news, so they can ask that. So this is the map of other things, you have to do it on your own. Ganga tributaries, you need to know the tributaries. Ganga tributaries are very important. Brahmaputra tributary has already been asked in the UPSC, so you can expect Ganga tributary, especially which tributary joins. For example, this is the course of Ganga, right? So which tributary joins first, which city, Patna, Gaya, something like that. So just prepare in your contemporary static grid, the river mapping. We will try to cover that in an impetus series, but we cannot promise that. You should always have a compilation for rivers. These things will help you in the examination. Bangladesh Rohingya relocation plan. So Thengchar facility as discussed. So this is Cox Bazar. So this is in Bangladesh. This is from Myanmar. From these Rakhine state, the Rohingyas are coming. area of detail, right? And they are said to be one of the, we'll see there, who are Rohingyas. So they are, UN has declared them the most persecuted community in the world. You can see that. So the term Rohingya comes from the old Arakan. Earlier Arakan was known as the Rohingya. Rohang basically, Rohingya or Rohingya, the indigenous people. But who are they? One of the 130 of ethnics of Myanmar, formerly Burma. Only ethnic they embrace Islam by the all the members. So they are Muslims in nature, Islam. They speak in Rohingya language, but they are persecuted by the Buddhist majority in the Bangladesh. Oh, sorry, in the Myanmar. Who said religion cannot be? Who said the Buddhism will do something like that, right? We've seen the atrocities in Sri Lanka, in the Myanmar, we can see. So it is not religion itself. It is just the political use of the religion. Religion itself, every dharma, no religion tells that enmity should be there. Okay, coming back to the topic. The location of the news, Syria in news. So you can ask, the questions can be asked that this particular city, for example, Raqqa is in news. Where do you find Raqqa? As in which country Raqqa is? So just remember the city. So first city we will see, because Syria is in too much news always, because the civil war and then ISIS, then Kurds. So that is why, okay, Kurds and all, you, that is your task. That is a static read, you do that. If important, we'll cover that into the international side of our discussion. Today is only indexes, locations, committees and random current affairs. The next session, we'll come up with the government schemes, then international, and we'll proceed like that. In very few time, we'll be able to cover the syllabus of October. So, you can see Azaz here, or Raqqa, you can see. The location, you don't have to remember too much locations, remember the important cities. Damascus is the capital, obviously Damascus is the capital. This is Kurds controlled Rojava. So these things can be asked. And one more city is there. This is Al Hasak. So we have covered all the five cities mentioned. This one is also there. Idlib is also there. You can add, obviously, whatever is the map in the video, you can add to your vocabulary. So we have seen this, we have seen this. All the cities, we have seen the location. Because these have been in news in the October, that is why. In the news means mentioned in Hindi or Indian Express or other newspapers. So that is why we have done it. Next. Makandhu. Ama Kunu Dhu. That is the westernmost atoll of Maldives. So just read about atoll reefs. Three reefs, fringing reef, barrier reef and atoll reefs. So China, what China is doing, their observation post, the string of pulse policy, right? So very beautiful post, but China is building their post there. Okay, Mukundu Island. So this is the string of pearls. Gwadar, just to reiterate, Hambantota, that is Krak Canal. Just remember the Krak Canal. Krak Canal is important. So they are breaking, in this is Thailand. So Krak Canal is trying to break, make a waterway. So that, why they are making so? So that, because a lot of Chinese product come from this route. For example, oil from this route. So they want to break it with Krak Canal. That is called as China's Malacca dilemma. That is why it want to control a lot of South Asia, South China Sea, one of the main reasons. So Krak Canal will give it the alternative route to reach there, and also the time and the cost efficiency, logistics will be more efficient there. Also, they are building the CPEC from there, from Gwadar to their province, so that the land route from there directly they can go to there. So they are building, trying to build routes so as to improve their efficiency, cost efficiency. Cocoa Island, China also has presence there. Cocoa Island location, if we see, this is Cocoa Island, this is Cocoa Island, this is Andaman Island. So this is Cocoa Channel, it's not mentioned here, that is Cocoa Channel. You also remember that some degree channels are there, 10 degree channel, 9 degree channel, 7 degree channel, 8 degree channel. In India, for example, Myanmar with Andaman and some islands are there, then India map is there, then Lakshadweep, then Maldives. Just remember those. I'm giving you a passing reference so that you can remember those, because those are important, right? If in the news, we'll cover that. Next is China expand airbase on the Cocoa Island. This is just a news. So D28, another, an iceberg named D28 is in news. So the location is Antarctica, huge iceberg breaks off. It is in the east of, and this is Antarctic. So it is somewhere over here where D20 broke off. It is different from the west of the continent of the, and which is rapidly warming due to climate change. So because of climate change, a lot of areas or the ice is melting. The tipping point, that can also be asked, the tipping point is. Is Google also tipping point? Tipping point is basically to the point from where there is a point of no return. So if too much melting is there, whatever happens, it cannot go back to the original source. So we need to measure the tipping point so that some quantitative description can come on the climate change. Okay. So the question is, how big is D20 iceberg? So greater, according to Greater London, not that much important, just the location is important. That's near the South Pole in the Antarctica there. Nothing. The question, if the question asks, they'll just, D20 was in news, and what is that? UPSC has been very, they don't want to check your vertical depth, with few exceptions in current affair. They just want to check your horizontal depth, the horizontally how much you are covering. So D20 is just an iceberg, just remember that. Giant iceberg break off the Antarctic and is known as D28. Okay. Okay, let's move. Next is Tulagi Islands. Tulagi Island is an island in the Solomon Island in the Pacific. Again, the Chinese poaching tendency, we can see. China recently took it for the lease for 75 years. You can see the they want to dominate the seas, right? Seas are the future. The whole Indo-Pacific, the Quad is based upon these steps of the China. That is why the countries like India, Australia, US, Japan are alarmed over such activities of China. Island of Tulagi served as a South Pacific headquarters of Britain, then Japan. Okay, the China firm a Pacific island deal. So this is Tulagi, you can see the location from there to Australia, you can see that, right? This is location wise, this is Great Barrier Reef, right? A very famous, everybody knows this, because in the childhood, like 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th class, we have paid a lot of attention to Great Barrier Reef. Okay. Next is Typhoon Hagibis. So this question can be like that, the Hagibis struck which country? Japan, Philippines, like that. So it has hit Japan. You can see the destruction, the typhoon. These events are becoming more in their intensity, uneven in their intensity and frequency due to climate change. Climate change is making a lot of changes in their intensity, in their frequency. Okay. Cyclone Kyar and Cyclone Maha. So you can see that it is in the Arabian Sea. So that becomes more important. Prevailed simultaneously over the Arabian Sea. Event of simultaneous cyclones. So that's a different event. That is why they become important, that they are the events of simultaneous cyclones in Arabian Sea, has occurred for the first time since 1965. Okay. Other details, if we see, categorized as the super cyclone, second super cyclone to be formed after the cyclone Gonu in 2007. Remnants of cyclone Kyar has led to another cyclone named Maha. Cyclone name Maha. Okay. So helped make 2019 the most active North Indian cyclone season on the record on the basis of accumulated cyclone energy. So Arabian Sea is the comparatively less prone to cyclone. You just read it, because due to low surface air condition, surface temperature. So this is a mains geography question, that why Bay of Bengal experiences more cyclone than Arabian Sea, and now the trend is a bit reversing. So that can be done in the geography static rate. Okay. This is the name. This is not important. Next come to Mount Paektu. Paektu. So this is at the border of the North Korea and the China and North Korea border. Can you tell me North Korea share borders with how many countries? It's South Korea, everybody knows, China we have discussed, and it also shares border with Russia also, just remember that. A small border it covers. At the height of the 900,000 feet, it is the highest peak in the Korean Peninsula. Okay, so this is your Mount Paektu, this is China, this is North Korea, Pyongyang. Okay. Next is, we come to the last section of our, very quickly, in within 1 hour, we are able to cover a lot of ground. Okay. So some random facts we will see. We'll try to, these facts cannot be categorized in any part. That is why we have done them separately. So that is first the Economics Nobel or Sevrigis. This is also the name of Economics Nobel Prize in the economic science 2019. So Sevrigis Risk Bank. So if in the state PCS, this type of question can come, right? The Economic Nobel Prize known as this prize, or who won this? If the question can come, not the economic, this prize, who won? Something like that. They just do these things. So why it is given? Research approach to elevating global poverty, and who has been given? The Indian JNU alumni, Abhijit Banerjee, his wife, and the other associate, Michael Kramer. So they did randomized control trial, because that Indian did this thing. So we need to know a little bit more about them. So in the long run, productivity and living standards in the poor country. So what they gave a randomized control trial. They come up with the experimental approach, not theoretical approach, right? So this the same prize goes to in the economics, in the memory of Alfred Nobel, goes to these thing, right? So again, the same thing. The work for the non-experimental part is there, the quasi-experimental is there, and experimental is there. So no need to read all this. Just I was telling you, the experimental, the more empirical things was done. Next is Sakharov Prize. Sakharov Prize is given by the European Parliament to those people who defend the human rights. You can, whenever human rights you are writing, especially in the optional, this value addition you can do, not the person itself, but how the Western countries are also appreciating too much human rights as they move around. The criticism is that that's a Western idea or something, but that's an optional thing. So this is Ilam Tohati is an Uyghur Muslim in the, for example, this is China. So China has done a lot of bad work with Uyghur Muslim. That is why many of the in India and even in the Pakistan, many criticize Imran Khan that he speaks too much about the atrocities on the Hindus or atrocities of the atrocities of Muslim in India. Allegedly he criticizes the Indian establishment, but when a very funny interview was there, he was asked about the Uyghur Muslims, then he said he didn't know anything, as if seems ignorant, because China, the Iron Brotherhood is there. So like, it is a hypocrisy on the part of Pakistan to say that, right? On the one hand, they are criticizing the atrocity of the Muslims in India, which is very not expected from the expected from the Pakistani establishment, but who himself has seen in his state, Balochistan, for example, when he was a candidate, he used to speak against what is happening Balochistan, Sindh, but currently criticizing India, not speaking on the Uyghur Muslim issue on the China. So that issue is becoming a lot more common, because now the US is also paying attention. A lot of human rights violation is there. So many detention camps have been set up, and China allows no one to keep a track there. They were just like a prisoners. Okay, now we come to the other Nobel Prizes. So in the physics, Nobel Prize is given for the two people, James Pebbles, two different set of people in that same category, as in cosmology and space research kind of a thing. So it helped revealing the wonders of the evolution of the universe and discovering the planets. Universal was in a, so what they come up with, you don't have to remember too much, but just remember that they have given the cosmology, because they have discovered something about the Big Bang. So for geography optional people, it becomes important. So the Pebbles had interpreted the first rays, the first ray, 5 lakh years later, the first ray of the light traveled through space. So what they say, the universe was in a hot and dense state, and 4 billion years ago there was a Big Bang, and then it started expanding and started cooling down. Big Bang happened and it cooled down, and 4 years later the first ray of the light traveled through space. these rays existed in cosmos are on omnipresent. Pebbles interpreted the first rays and showed that in the universe just 5% are known in the matter, rest is unknown, dark matter and energy. Rest is dark matter and energy. Okay. Similarly, this exoplanet was researched by this by the other fellow, this one, that Michael Mayer and they are Coelho's for the names are a bit tough. So they have find an exoplanet. Exoplanet is basically a planet outside the solar system. So, first type of exoplanet orbiting a solar type star. It is as big as Jupiter. It is also close to its very star. So, question is why it became so close to its star? So, a theory is floated that led to theories that described how large balls falls off the edge of the solar system. Very large were there. Then he falls from the solar system, they spiral and they become close to the star. A bit of geography is there. So, but still, like, that's a hypothesis, and why such a big star is near the star, the big planet is near the star, and therefore that hypothesis and his research, he got the, these two people have got the prize. The same thing is mentioned there also, Pebbles, the work of Pebbles and work of Mayers and Coelho's. Okay, now we come to medicine Nobel Prize, discovering the details of how the body cells sense and react to low oxygen level, providing foothold to the developing a new treatment for anemia, cancer and the other disease. So basically, when the low oxygen level is there, then what, how body cells are responding. So this is for this research, they are given the research. I am giving you the context. For example, Nobel Prize are not in the news, UPSC will not ask those, state PCS can ask those questions. But just for the reference, and especially they can ask the other part of things. For example, what the Abhijit Banerjee work he did, something like that, and similar for others. So for UPSC prelims, you should consider not the too much the factual part, but also the conceptual part behind it. That is why the integration of current affair with the contemporary is very complementary strategy is very important. Details. So it present the kidney releases the hormone called EPO, this is erythropoietin, so which tells body to make up more blood cells and carry on more oxygen around. It was founded on the protein called hypoxia inductive factor, which rises when there is less oxygen around. Okay, next is chemistry Nobel Prize. So it is given to the electric vehicle revolution happening all over the world, which have reshaped the energy storage and transformed the cars, mobiles, and obviously because we have to reduce the dependence on the fossil fuel. Why? First of all, the resources are limited, and second, they are polluting. The most important part is polluting. The pollution part is creating a lot of problem to cover our Paris Pledge, sustainable development goals and everything. So lithium becomes very important. It is the lightest metal. What's the atomic number of lithium? 3. Okay, so to give the electrons to the generate the voltage. So it is given to the Nobel Prize in chemistry, John B. Goodenough. Okay, the name is interesting, na? Goodenough. Okay, Mr. Stanley Whitham and Akira Yoshino for development of lithium ion batteries. Why does this research matter? Obviously, because many of the devices that we use are powered by the lithium batteries. You should also make a homework that what are the lithium triangle, what are the country in the lithium triangle in the South America, which India is negotiating to get the lithium for our digital devices, because we have also national electronics manufacturing policy, right? National manufacturing policy in which we want to create a digital devices. Why we want to create digital devices on our own? Because of the cyber security threat. Because majority of our hardware comes from outside. So whatever we do on the software side, if the core hardware is coming from the outside, then there will be an cyber security threat, will always be there. Next is Nobel Peace Prize for Ethiopian PM Abiy Ahmed. Now why he resolved the long running conflict with the neighboring Eritrea. So the conflict started in 1998 and 20 years it carried on. I'm just giving you the context. July 1998, the conflict ended. Basically, it was a conflict between Ethiopia and Eritrea, in which Eritrea attacked and then re-attacked and something like that. So these two are very poor countries, and they were involved in the in the civil war, not civil wars, obviously they are involved in the lot of war and bringing a misery. A lot, millions of dollars have been wasted. The UN peacekeeping force has to be done. So finally, this prime minister said that Mr. Abiy Ahmed said that we will follow the peace agreement formed in 2000. Those details are not important. I'm just giving the story so that you are able to remember the fact. So finally, the peace, we have very less people. For example, on one hand, Trump's want to bomb Iran, And we need people like him so that the peace can be restored. He can be a good example for ethics also. Just remember that every year the Nobel Peace Prize is given to some person, he can be a potential ethics example. So if you've seen some of the video on ethics on the YouTube also, so I've been taking the ethics also. So these Peace Prize can be a very good example for the ethics, right? Kailash Satyarthi is being given the Peace Prize. So Idria location is this. This is the Horn of Africa, Djibouti, Ethiopia, Somalia, and Eritrea. Just try to remember the capitals of the other countries. Capital of Somalia is that is your homework. Djibouti, Ethiopia is Addis Ababa. So just mention that is your homework. Just no, Somalia, and also keep remember the capital of different countries, especially of the Central Asian countries. Okay, Central Asian countries capital is important. Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, Kazakhstan, because their confusion is a lot of confusion. And also try to remember factual content slowly. Don't, if you just put the map and you want to cram it, that will not happen. But slowly, if you see the map, for example, capital of Eritrea is Asmara. So just remember these facts. Try to remember this. So more you see these facts, the more you will remember. Don't try to do an specific study of the capitals. Next is military nursing service. So it's celebrated. Why it is in news? It's celebrated some rising year. Why important? It's the only women corps in armed forces, right? Military nursing services. So it came into being 1988. So pre-British legacy is there. So just have a keep in mind that all women corps is there for armed forces, military nursing service. The thing I discussed, IUC, you must be, if you are a Geo follower or the Airtel or something, you know that this happened. 6 paisa per minute charges are now being cast, and they have made some package and also that. And recently every operator has also increased the cost of the tariff. For example, earlier I used to recharge for Jio only 399, now that has been increased to 599. So cost is there. So it is related to telecom sector, paid by one operator to the other when the customer make the outgoing call from one operator to the other. For example, if I make call from Jio to Jio, so nothing will happen. But if I make a call from Jio to Airtel, I will be charged. Something like, very easy concept, nothing else. So world over, the companies have moved to the zero IUC regime. Earlier it was there in India, but for example, they're fixed first of all by TRAI. Somewhere we'll cover the TRAI also, because the bodies, Indian institutions are also very important. So what is this? Originating network, and this is terminating network. So he will pay him, something like that. Very easy concept, what I told you. So you see this, interconnect rethink. So in January 2020, so from that a new judgment, now new policy from TRAI is expected, so that they can move to the zero IUC regime. So January, when we'll discuss current affairs, so again we'll revisit that if some changes happen. But TRAI has come, so that the TRAI has cut the IUC by 57% to 6 paisa per minute. Currently it is 6 paisa per minute, and called for scrapping it by January 2020, right? Which committee was established? Rajiv Gauba committee, remember that. Telecom sector mein stress mein, Rajiv Gauba committee. Okay, next is the last fact, I guess, the world's first graduate level research based in AI, that is in UAE. AI University is there, so it is based in UAE, Mohammed Zayed University of Artificial Intelligence. Okay, so a UAE location, I will cover, it's very small location, it's not even, just remember that, huh? Good fact that Tropic of Cancer passes through UAE, apart from the 8 states in India, it passes also through UAE. I mean, you never know when it will come in handy. So very crisp and good session we had, around 1 hour we spent with each other. But I'll tell you, revise the contemporary static, complementary static, again the same mistake I'm making. So revise the complementary static portion, and trust us, we are trying to make a very good course on current affairs. It is a pursuit, we are striving for making a very crisp and a very good content, so that the worries of the current affair get resolved. Thank you, see you in the next session.